Skydio 3D Scan is the first of its kind adaptive scanning solution for fully automated data capture. So no matter the structure, the scene, the shape, or the size, we will automatically figure out what is in the scene. We will determine a flight pattern to capture a complete and full data set, and we will execute it completely autonomously. The objective is to capture that full data set with a high level of confidence, such that you can take that data, use it for pure inspection use cases, or downstream, take it to some of the leading photogrammetry software engines. The key here is that Skydio 3D Scan is meant to be a tool for any worker, not just a skilled pilot. One of the key differentiators of 3D Scan versus other products is that regardless of what you're trying to capture or what you're trying to scan, the workflow is essentially the same. The first step of executing a 3D scan is defining the area that contains the structure or scene that you wish to scan. And the way you do that is you first define a floor, which is the bottom, the ceiling, which is the top, and the sides by defining some sort of lateral boundaries. And the idea is you've constructed this 3D scan area that contains the structure you wish to scan. After that, Skydio will autonomously explore that area. It will fly around it completely autonomously, and it will build an onboard map of what is contained within. Using that information, the Skydio drone will propose a flight pattern that will completely encompass the structure, achieving full coverage once flown. And just before executing the flight, you have the ability to change various settings. For those of you in this industry, these will all be things that you're used to. In this case, they'll be in 3D. This would be like overlap, sidelap, distance from the structure, and resolution in terms of GSD. Once a drone is flying, you really become just, you're just there to monitor the drone's progress. You're not there to intervene. You're not there to be a pilot. All you have to do is monitor the drone's progress. And we have added quite a few tools that allow you to see that you're getting the coverage that you set out to in the beginning. And you can do all of that in the field to be sure that you have got the data that you set out to capture. The top right shows something that we call the augmented reality observer or AR observer. This allows you to set a sort of third-person perspective that you wish to monitor the progress of the scan from. This is incredibly useful for 3D objects. Like in this scenario, this is an example of a telecom tower being scanned. The operator chose where they wanted to view the scan from, and then we will project the drone in augmented reality. And we will also project this thing called the AR coverage mesh, which is what shows you that you're getting the overlap and the sidelap that you specified initially. So, top right, what you're seeing is the drone flying around the tower along the automated flight path, and you're seeing the coverage mesh turn from yellow to purple, which is indicative of you getting full coverage. In the bottom, this is another view of that AR coverage mesh, but this is from the perspective of the drone itself. You can easily switch between either one of these at any time during the flight. And the key is that you're an operator, you're not a pilot, you're just monitoring progress, gaining confidence that the data you set out to capture is being captured. We have this tool called the Edge Model Viewer. This runs on the drone itself. It is available minutes after landing. It allows you to view the images in full resolution. It allows you to view that augmented reality coverage mesh. You also have the ability to pick a point on that coverage mesh, which is sort of a rough 3D model, and you can view all of the images contained within that point. And that is a really quick way to do a field inspection in near real time. Make sure you've got what you need and/or make a call right there on the spot. There are a couple of different scan modes. So the first is 3D capture, and this is really the one that is made for high-fidelity 3D models or capture of complex 3D scenes for pure inspection use cases. You can see the drone has captured it from all angles, above, below, and from the sides. We also have a 2D capture capability within 3D scan, but this isn't necessarily the type of 2D capture that you're used to. In this case, this is also something that you can fly in a GPS-denied environment without pre-planning, without any preparation, and of course, Skydio autonomy and obstacle avoidance is active at all times. While flying, The only other thing to think about is once the battery gets low, and in this case, we will also handle that for you. So the drone will automatically return to the launch location or another location that you have preset at the beginning of the workflow. You can swap the battery, automatically take off and resume. And the key difference here between what you may be used to is that the drone will continue where it left off, even if you're in a GPS denied environment, such as underneath a bridge, next to a building, or some other challenging environment. And to reiterate, we are compatible with all of the leading photogrammetry engines, drone deploy, reality capture, Bentley, Esri site scan, and Pix4D. So with that, I'm excited to hand things off to Peter to talk about his awesome UAS program with the New York Power Authority and how he's using 3D scan.
Good afternoon, everyone. I've been at my position now for about 9 months, and I'm retooling New York Power Authority's idea of how to use UAS. From what I'm noticing here at the Power Authority, one mission can solve 9-10 different questions to different departments. They just need to know that the data's there. Before I got here, we were all, the authority was really big on capturing videos. When we take just a photo and you take a boatload of photos, you can get these point clouds. When we start getting these point clouds, this is where we can start doing volumetric measurements, elevation differences, the heights, even tagging problems that we might have with a structure. So instead of New York Power Authority is across the whole state of New York, to have engineers from New York City to come up here into St. Lawrence, it's time and money to come and check out a problem. If we can do a quick map or a quick little scan of an area, everyone can see it right then and there in front of them in a digital twin type of environment. And this is where we really want to focus, because if we can start improving our digital twins, we can save more time and money on the back end of it. 3D scan has been a very big, important point for us here. We're updating our power grid for New York State, downstate to New York City. We are scanning every single new tower that we are building and keeping the digital twin. What this is doing for us is, A, we know what it looks like when we first installed it. Where I'm aiming for my project to get to in the winter is before the winter, we'll do another scan. Before first snowfall, we'll do another scan. After the building, the tower's frozen solid and it thaws out, we do another scan and try to do predictive maintenance instead of reactionary maintenance. For this, our guys have made a little procedure on how to do this. Now everyone's like, well, how long does it take to scan one tower? It's 15 minutes. If I'm required to go and fly these complex motions and create a 3D model, we all know how difficult that is. Very difficult if you don't know how to operate. And we can't go out and hire 10 professional pilots because they cost too much. It's not scalable. Their drones have been very effective in cutting down waste of time and moving forward with their software. This is how we can benefit for the future, not just for today. Once it flies it and it comes back and it takes right off and it continues right to where it stopped taking its photos, which has really put a lot of our new pilots at ease, because they don't need to have my flying skill or some of your advanced pilot skills that are needed for other missions. They're really easy to fly up and close to the tower without fear of falling into the tower. But as you can see with the picture on the left, the original, it's not any good. As they start getting more and more comfortable, they start flying closer and closer to the structure and see the necking of the bolt. That's where we see the benefits. The facts are they're moving. Their autonomy is really robust and we trust it. We fly it inside our switchyards while they're energized, which is a big deal. Some other manufacturers, we can't do that. Guys before and prior years have attempted it and it's never ended well. We're flying in 765 kV yard while it's energized. And the modeling has been really beneficial for current projects and future projects that we're working on. EPRI back in December did a study where they told us that the energized lines did not have any effect on your systems. And so from that, we took a deep dive and we did an experiment, and we haven't seen any problems yet come from this. We have a rule in place where it's only your aircraft is actually allowed to fly in our switch guards while it's energized. Also, cybersecurity, having an American-made drone makes it easier.